one of the persons having worked in this field for, I think, the longest time, at least focusing on K-12, you are one of the most prominent people up to date. I think this is a very, for us, a very big honor to have you here and to listen to your experience of the way this field is, has been or is moving at the moment. So I'm gonna do a thing that I'm not really sure if I can, but I'm gonna spotlight you, which means that everyone sees you and your presentation.
Okay, cool.
So yes. So welcome, Michael, and please, thank you.
Okay. I'm Michael Barbour. I'm at Toro University, California, which is a private Jewish university located in Vallejo, which is just outside of San Francisco in the Bay Area. It's part of actually a university system, so we have about 30 campuses worldwide, mostly in the metropolitan New York area. And each of the campuses are relatively small. We've got about 2,000 students here at here in California, and I think there's about 23,000 total throughout the 30 odd campuses that we have. So basically, I was asked to sort of talk about where we've been and how we got to where we are right now, and for also that matter, to sort of situate a little bit of where we are right now, because obviously we're not in normal times, if you will. So when we look at distance education in general at the K-12 level, it's really followed a similar trajectory that we see in higher education. So as best we can tell, at least in North America, some of the first correspondence programs that we saw were developed in the early 1900s, 1906, and actually in British Columbia is the first one we can find in North America. That's about 25 years after the first program that we saw in higher education. That moves to educational radio, which, you know, our colleagues in Australia, for example, have used a great deal and still do for that matter, used a lot in the American Midwest as well. Instructional television, which again was used a lot in the American Midwest. We saw it used in a number of Asian countries as their main method in the 1980s. Telematics or audiographics was the dominant technology, used a lot in Canada as well as in Australia. And then we move into 1991 is the year that the first online school opened up in the United States. Now, when you're looking at, again, North American, I'll apologize that a lot of what we have in the history is North American. And that's largely in part because while there is a little bit written about the development of K-12 distance education and K-12 online learning in Australia and New Zealand, and to a lesser extent, South Korea, the vast majority of what's written, at least in English language publications, has tended to focus upon the North American context, and in particular, the American context. So even Canada often gets lost in that mix. Now, my French is, you know, comme ci, comme ça. I know that most folks in Europe speak multiple languages, so you guys would probably have a better sense of what some of the K-12 literature talks about over there compared to what I would have. But when we're looking at the online schools, the online learning in the essentially North America, the first private online school was developed in 1991 here in California. Laurel Springs School was the name. The first full-time public programs began in 94. The first supplemental programs began in 93. Most people sort of see the field as really taking off in 96 when the Florida Virtual School and the Virtual High School Consortium were created. By 2001, because you had a lot of states that were putting out both state-based grants, and there was a fair amount of federal funding available in the U.S. We saw a number of states that started to get involved in it. So by the early 2000s, you're looking into the two to three dozen states. You'll also note K-12 Inc. And Connections Academy were both founded in 2001. Those are the two main companies that provide cyber charter schools in the US. As you look through, you can sort of see the numbers increasing till you get up to about 2010. 2011 is finally when every state plus the District of Columbia has some form of online learning going on. And if we were to continue out this, what you'd find is that right now we estimate that there are probably somewhere in the neighborhood of anywhere from 3 to 5 million students that are engaged in supplemental forms of online learning in the U.S. That works out to about 5% of the K-12 population, probably in the neighborhood of about 1 million students involved in full-time online learning. So you're looking at really small numbers. In Canada, that's about the same. I think last year we had 6.1% of the students that had taken one or more courses online. Two reports I'll mention there that you see on the bottom of the scale. In 2003, the Evergreen Consortium, or Evergreen Consulting, sorry, out of Colorado, began producing their Keeping Pace reports. And for each year thereafter, they did those. And essentially, that was a telling of what was happening on a state-by-state basis, both in terms of the activity, but also the legislative slash regulatory environments that existed. In 2009, I've been leading since then a group of researchers that essentially do the same type of report. In Canada, we call it the State of the Nation report. Both of those reports are available online, freely available. So if you search Keeping Pace with K-12 Online Learning or State of the Nation K-12 Online Learning, you'll find the websites for both those projects and be able to look through them. Now, I've mentioned a couple of terms as I've been going through this idea of supplemental online learning and full-time online learning. So supplemental is where the students are registered in a physical or brick and mortar school, and they may be taking one or more courses online to supplement things that they can't get in the classroom or things that just might not fit into their schedules. These students have all of the trappings and support that you would normally find in a typical brick and mortar school. In most cases, these students, when they engage in their online learning, do so within the school building, oftentimes in a distance learning room or learning resource center. So they have the ability to access, you know, that technology support. In many cases, they're assigned a facilitator or an on-site mentor. In fact, in some states, it's actually required. And it's interesting, I forgot to mention one thing with the timeline. You'll notice up here that in 2006, Michigan becomes the first state in the U.S. to require students to have some sort of online learning experience in order to graduate from high school. By the mid-2010s, there were actually 12 states that had some kind of requirement like that. Many of them have now backed off, and there are only 6 left in the U.S. that still have that requirement. Starting with the incoming class that began their high school careers this past September, all students in the Canadian province of Ontario are going to be required to take 2 online courses in order to graduate from high school. So these would be the supplemental kinds of kids. You know, the kids that are in the U.S., oftentimes students that have to take an advanced placement course that live in a rural area, so there's not enough students interested to warrant having a class for it. I imagine you guys get a lot of the same stuff in rural and remote areas in Sweden. When you're looking at the U.S., you can see the states here in green are the ones that have significant activity when it comes to supplemental that we know about. Now, I say that we know about because you can see that they say that there are states that have state virtual schools. So these are supplemental programs. Now, the difficulty is that a lot of the online learning that happens in the U.S. happens under the radar. So as an example, I was involved as an expert witness in a court case in Missouri a couple of years ago where the school district had both a supplemental program They had a full-time at-home program as well as a full-time at-school program. So they had three different types of online programs. But yet the students in that district were all registered in a brick-and-mortar school, regardless of what they did. So according, because none of the other ones had school identification codes. So based upon what the state knew, the state had no idea that students were enrolled in online programs or face-to-face programs. They were all enrolled in, you know, George Washington High School or Franklin Roosevelt High or what have you. And there's a lot of that that happens in the U.S. And that's one of the reasons why we don't have good numbers on the supplemental programs. Now, the full-time programs are the other type. Now, these are kids that will never step foot, or at least during that particular academic year that they're enrolled, they don't step foot into a brick and mortar school. So they do 100% of their schooling online. You'll note that often that means that they don't have those types of support that you would often find in a traditional brick and mortar school. Because of that, what ends up happening is that the parent or the guardian actually has a formal role in this environment. They're called a learning coach. And based upon some of the court cases we've seen in the U.S., the learning coach actually is the main source of instructional support for the student. It's one of the reasons why I've sort of pejoratively referred to this as glorified homeschooling, where the state is essentially paying for the student and parent to have access to an online curriculum and access to an on-demand tutor, because that's usually what it amounts to in most of these programs. These are the type of programs that tend to be run by for-profit corporations in the guise of cyber charter schools. So what ends up happening a lot of times is they have significantly high student-teacher ratios in comparison to what we see in the supplemental or the public programs. Students also perform incredibly poorly in these kinds of environments. When we look at actually sort of where the folks are doing this, because these are set up as separate schools, we can track these a little bit better. So you can see the figures here from the 2019-2020 school year. Now, this was pre-pandemic. It's 2018-2019 school year. So you can see that in most states, the full-time population is in the 1% or less range. So you can see Pennsylvania, which is the highest there, it's 2.09%. All the rest are 1 point something or 0 point something. So the number of students engaged in this is actually quite small. Now, when you're looking at the research, and I'm going to jump to the research just for a minute. I know my colleague, Jared Borup, who I've been chatting with in the earlier this evening, it's like 12:15 a.m. my time here. He gets the better slot because he's on the East Coast. So it's going to be like 9 o'clock his time in the morning. So that's I know he's going to talk a little bit more about the research and the theory and stuff like that. But I did want to point out a couple of things. So a group of doc students at BYU and I did a study a couple of years ago where we looked at the time, it was the 356 articles related to K-12 online learning that we were able to identify. And while I can say it probably wasn't every article that was published on K-12 online learning in the English language, I'm confident that we got most of them. And it's interesting because one of the things, I mean, you can see the top 10 journals here and that kind of stuff, but I want to point out the third bullet point there, that if you're looking at 356 articles, 102 of them were published in journals where they only published a single article about K-12 distance education, which likely means that the editors probably had no background knowledge, expertise, or understanding of K-12 online learning. And in most cases, the reviewers probably didn't either. Obviously, they didn't have anything else in that particular journal to be able to cite to inform what they did. Similarly, when you looked at those 356 articles, there were 384 distinct authors. 276 of those, so just about 75% of them, had published a single article in the field, and that's it. So not only is about a third of the articles that are being published, published in journals that have no background expertise or experience with the field, but 75% of the articles that are being written are written by people that have no background expertise or experience in the field. And it's one of the reasons why I think when you look at the field in general, and Jared will talk a little bit more about this at the end of the day, we've got a field that really isn't developed. It's, you know, even though we've been doing this for 30 years now, the first article came out 25 years ago. When you look at just K-12 online learning, that doesn't count, you know, the 100 years of experience we've got with K-12 distance education before that. Really, it's an immature field that hasn't really built upon itself that well for a variety of reasons. And this is probably one of the biggest ones. So that sort of gets you up to about February of 2020. And then we all know what happens after that. You know, and when you look at what we saw happening, I mean, for the most part, at least here in North America, and I suspect it was pretty similar around the world, at least based on the coverage that I've seen, we pretty much switched to what one of my colleagues refers to as Zoom school. Because we had a bunch of teachers that had really little background in these technologies. They had little understanding of the pedagogy that was, you know, that you needed to undertake when you're in a distance medium. So they essentially just tried to do what they used to do when they were in the classroom, but now do it in a screen like this. And that was pretty much it. And in instances where they couldn't do that, I mean, we saw news reports of all sorts of creative things that were happening around where, you know, we had teachers going out to parent, you know, the kids' schools and teaching them through the storm door, or, you know, preparing math equations for them on their driveway and stuff like that. And, you know, and it, while it was creative and it was interesting to see, and in April and May of last year, my hat's off to anybody who did any of those things, because this was something that they weren't prepared for. You know, it really wasn't good education. And it's not only wasn't good education, but there's been a lot of literature that's been coming out in the past year that has been looking at the idea that it wasn't even online, not that it wasn't good online learning or good distance education, but it wasn't actually distance education. So Chuck Hodges and a group of colleagues wrote this in EDUCAUSE, basically, what was it, March. So, you know, within a few weeks of the pandemic starting. And they really went through and tried to delineate the difference between what they described as emergency remote teaching and online learning. I was fortunate enough that I managed to get Chuck and his team on board. Plus, we engaged Kevin Kelly and Phil Hill as well. And Randy Labonte and myself tried to essentially do a K-12 version of this. And this report is available on our State of the Nation website. Freely available. So if you go to the website there and just click on research reports, you'll see the link to it there. But what essentially we tried to do was taking a look at what does emergency remote teaching look like and how is it different for online learning. So this is the way Chuck and his colleagues described online learning. And, you know, I won't go through and read this for you, but I will highlight some of the key things here. And I'll point out some specific words, you know, purposeful planning, systematic procedures, careful consideration, you know, best suited to the affordances and challenges, purposeful selection, careful planning, teachers appropriately trained, you know, et cetera, et cetera. That's online learning. You know, when you actually sit down and figure out, okay, we have these type of learners, we want to, you know, address them. Here's the needs that they have. How can we go about doing this and doing this effectively? This is what happened in March, well, probably April in most cases, because March we were just trying to figure out, you know, what was going to happen and how long we were going to be at this. And in most cases, how we were going to provide the necessities that school often provides, like lunch and you know, some of those others more basic needs, if you will. And then we also had to figure out how to get, you know, technology to all the kids. But when you look at the definition that they had for emergency remote teaching, again, looking at some of these key words, you know, it's a temporary shift that's simply in place because of crisis circumstances, you know, that we're only doing this remote teaching because, you know, it's something that it's a temporary solution to otherwise delivering it face to face, you know, and once the crisis is over, we're going to go back to that face to face environment. You know, we're not trying to create a robust educational system here. It's temporary. You know, it's quick to set up and hopefully reliably available during an emergency or crisis. Although now that we're, I guess, 14 months into this now, I'm not sure how reliably available it has been to us throughout that entire period. But you can really see the difference between something that, you know, was planned and prepared and thought about, and then something that we simply did on the fly because it was the only thing that was available to us, or the easiest thing that was available to us. And, you know, when we think about the nature of pandemics, I mean, you know, this is something that happens on a more regular basis than what you would normally expect. I mean, if you look at sort of the history of major pandemics that we have, there's at least one in every single century that we've recorded now since really, you know, the 1-200s. In recent years, that's tended to be 2 to 4. And, you know, if you look right down at the bottom, we've had 5 global pandemics since the turn of the millennium. You know, so we went from having 1 or 2 a century to 2 to 4 a century to now having 5 in the last 20, 21 years. Right. So, you know, think about what's going to happen 3-4 years from now when the next one rolls around. And it's not just a single type event because, you know, as we've come to learn with this one, you know, we don't necessarily know what the waves are going to look like. But we know that there's going to be waves. This is not a one-time occurrence that we just ride out for a short period of time. You know, this is something that's going to keep coming at us. So when you're looking at this from an educational perspective, you really sort of want to be thinking about this in from a pandemic planning perspective, 3 phases, but then looking at how those 3 phases are going to impact what happens when this is all over. So if you look at phase 1 here, this is essentially March and April of last year, to a lesser extent, May, you know, and at least in North America. And I apologize, I don't know if you guys are year-round schooling that starts in January and goes through like my colleagues in New Zealand and Australia, or if you're a Labor Day to June group like the North American model. But, you know, depending upon where you were in the school year, either relatively early into it or as we were over here getting near the end of it, you know, phase 1 basically was for the end of our school year. We had some teachers that were moving into phase 2, those that may have been a little bit more technologically inclined in the first place, those that were in schools or districts that were already engaged in more blended learning. So they already had the devices and the students were already familiar with a lot of the tools. But for the most part, the vast majority of schools over in North America on that September to June model or the August to May model, depending upon where you are in North America, stayed in phase 1 during the 2019-2020 school year. Now, they had the opportunity to move to phase 2 or 3, ideally phase 3 by the time September rolled around. But for most places, that didn't happen. And I'll get that to the next slide. Now, the next thing that we need to start thinking about is what happens next. I mean, you know, we're at a point now where we have a fair amount of the population that's been vaccinated. You know, that plus the folks that have already had it, we're getting to close to where we may be achieving some measure of herd immunity. So what does, you know, the impact of the last 14 months to 16 months by the time we're out of this have when we start up, at least for us, in September of 2021? Now, I say that they should have moved to phase three in the fall of 2020 over here in North America. And in order to do that, they would have needed to, you know, each of these three levels would have needed to do these 10 things that I've got on the screen. Although you'll see the districts and the schools have some commonalities there. You know, one of the things that didn't happen in a single jurisdiction in North America, you know, we know that depending upon the nature of the school system in the 2019-2020 school year, at best, schools managed to get through 80% of the time that was allotted to education. The other 20% was disrupted. And some teachers might have gotten through a lot during that disruption. Most got through very little. You know, so we already knew that we were starting the 2021 school year behind as it was. And we should have known, based upon, you know, this idea of having to go back and forth, toggling between different modalities, that there were going to be disruptions in this school year. Any educational jurisdiction out there should have looked at their curriculum and said, okay, what things do we cover in grade three that are absolutely necessary for a student to know in grade four in order to have success the following year? Let's tell the teachers, you know, what 60% of the curriculum they have to cover. And if they can cover another 10% or another 20%, that's great. You know, because they're already going to have to make up some of the grade two stuff that the students didn't get last year anyway. You know, over here, we call them power standards. But what are those power standards that you need to have for the curriculum continuity purposes? And there wasn't a single jurisdiction in North America that did that to essentially guide teachers to say, here's what's absolutely necessary to cover over the next year. Here's the stuff we'd like you to do. If you have to drop stuff, here's the stuff you can drop. And, you know, that's just the first thing that, well, actually, it's the second thing on the list. Providing early guidance was the first thing, which they totally blew, because in most cases it was weeks, sometimes days before school, sometimes after school had to check, was supposed to have officially started, was when they started to provide a lot of this guidance. You know, and when you look at some of these other things, very few jurisdictions did this in a way that would have prepared us. And, you know, when you start looking at what was happening, I mean, it's one of the reasons why over here we had, you know, these mass waves of resignations, or in unionized school jurisdictions, you had folks that had like 6 months of sick time built up or leave built up, and they took all 6 months of it last, you know, at the beginning of the year, just so they wouldn't have to deal with this stuff. You know, we only had 1 in 5 teachers saying that they were actually prepared by their school leaders to be able to teach in this environment. You know, we had these kind of ridiculous models that were put together where, you know, you had a teacher that was responsible for teaching one group of students in the classroom 2 days a week, that same group of students at home 2 days a week, and then you also had the other half of the class that they flipped. So if you're sort of looking at that, that means I've got to prepare in-class lessons on Monday and distance lessons on Monday, in-class lessons on Tuesday and distance classes on Tuesday, just distance on Wednesday, and then back to the both in-class and distance on the following days, which essentially means I've got to do 4 days worth of in-class stuff, 4 days and basically 5 days worth of distance stuff. That means I've got to prepare 9 days worth of activities for my students in a 7 day week. Well, actually in a 5 day week, according to this, because they assume that teachers are lazy and don't work on the weekends. You know what I mean? And instead of actually looking at it and saying, you know, okay, like we've got 3 grade 3 teachers, John, you do all of the online stuff, and we're going to get, you know, Tom and Jane to split the 2 groups that they're doing in person. So that way we can, you know, divide this up a little bit and, you know, make the work equitable. And that probably would have worked quite well, because you've got to figure that if John was a teacher that had a pre-existing condition or was an older teacher, you know, they might relish the opportunity to not be in front of students and have that potential, you know, risk taken away from them. You know, and then we also had, you know, the idiotic idea that, you know, teachers could do both of it at the same time. And this actually is the way they did it in Canada a great deal, where you had what you refer to as roomies and zoomies at the same time. So I might have 5 or 6 kids or 10 or 12 kids in my class that I'm teaching. And on the classroom computer, I'm also Zooming so that I can have another 10 or 12 or 15 kids at home that are doing this without equipping the classroom with any additional technology. So that laptop that I use to project up onto the screen for the students in the room, that's the same laptop I'm using to actually stream to the kids at home, which means they can only see me, assuming I stand in front of my computer. And I don't know about you guys, but when I teach, I meander all about the room. So that would have been pretty useless for me. They can't see their fellow students because it's always pointed towards the teacher. So it's not like you can interact between those at home and those in the room. And, you know, when you've got these kinds of models, as you can see here, it's no wonder that teachers reported to being burnt out on a regular basis. You know, and it wasn't just the teachers. So when you look at the way in which the students were interacting in this, you know, I mean, we had countless examples of kids that, you know, were either not able to get access to the technology or had to do ludicrous things like, you know, walking to, actually, in this case, if you look at the CNN story or the KCRA story at the bottom, you know, walking an hour to get to school just so he could lie outside of the building and get on the computer there, or the two, you know, elementary school kids that are sitting in the parking lot of a Taco Bell to get on the Wi-Fi there. You know, and that's the students that we could find. You know, as you can see from the main CNN story at the top, most schools were losing students left and right when they went 100% remote. They just couldn't get them. You know, in some cases, these are students that were homeless. So in terms of trying to get the technology to them was difficult. In many cases, you know, they were students that were English language learners. So there was already a barrier set up to be able to interact between the home and school anyway. I know in California here, they estimate that as many as 8% of the K-12 student population just weren't enrolled in school this year. You know, that's almost one out of every 10 kids that, you know, just were lost for a full year. You know, and you know, even those that were able to show up, I mean, one of the things that we had, and I encourage you to just to read through the comment that my colleague Mary Rice, who's a faculty member at the University of New Mexico, wrote up there, accounting, you know, or recounting something that she heard in her daughter's class. You know, and, you know, while kids are resilient, I mean, everyone has their breaking point. And one of the things that we know about learning is that a student will do well when they feel like their teacher actually cares about them. They actually give a damn about them, right? And in these kinds of environments, when you get these kinds of things happening, you know, it's really difficult to convey that sense of caring and trust and empathy and, you know, the fact that you actually do care about whether or not they're having success on the other end of that. So when you look at these things, I mean, I've kind of color coded them here to show you sort of what I saw happening. You know, districts and schools did a little bit, or, you know, an average job, let's say, on addressing digital equity and providing professional development. They did a little bit when it came to standardizing their tools and understanding community realities. They did nothing when it came to providing early guidance, nothing on curriculum continuity, nothing on reconsidering assessment. In fact, here it's either they decided that state assessments or provincial assessments would go ahead or they wouldn't go ahead. And even in places where they would go ahead, the federal government has already come out this year, for example, and said that states don't have to have them. So if the state decides to have it, any parent can opt out and there's no actual penalty for doing that if a parent actually bothers to look at it. You know, and there are other things that are happening as well, because what we've had in the past year is really a reliance on technology for a lot of these things without doing a lot of checking. So this is a report that came out actually about a week and a half ago that the NEPC puts out every other year, virtual schools in the U.S. And one of the things we talked about in it was when you look at actually what a lot of schools adopted, you know, because they had to do this so quickly, they weren't able to create content. So the easiest thing for them to do is just go out and purchase content. But when you purchase content from a vendor, you never know what you're getting. And this Acelus company that, you know, had vendors, or they had schools in, I think it was 39 different states that they had contracts with. And I mean, you can see some of the lessons that, you know, or examples from the lessons that they had that just made it to the media. And I mean, this is, you know, just a selection of them. And apparently these are ones that were, while egregious in their, you know, illustrations, they are still ones that were not as bad as some of the other ones. In fact, I remember talking with one reporter from Southern California that said some of the things that one of the parents showed him were things that he didn't even feel comfortable printing because of how offensive they were. Right. And I mean, you can see, you know, these examples here between, you know, the racist and sexist nature of it. It's not just the nature of the actual content that we've got here. So there's another couple of reports that I'd encourage you to look at. And all these are available on the National Education Policy Center's website. But these two reports actually look at the issue of privacy. And I have to say, you guys do a much better job when it comes to the European Union laws around student privacy and privacy in general of just the average citizen compared to what we have here in North America. But, you know, this is just one example. And I point you in particular, I mean, you can sort of skim through all of it. But if you look at the last paragraph in particular, you know, Nearpod retains content, including student content, for as long as a teacher has an account. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I'm willing to bet that if you were to go and search on MySpace, I probably still have an active account on MySpace. Because like most people, when you move from a tool to a new tool, you don't go back and delete your account on the other one. You just stop using it, right? And I'm sure we all have, you know, dozens, maybe even hundreds of accounts out there that are still active, that are still there, right? And in this case, you know, if it's a corporate provider, they still have access to these things. And when you look at who they share it with and what types of things get shared, you know, it becomes really scary considering that we're making these decisions for 5 and 6 year olds. You know, and I point out all of these things, not necessarily because you know, we can do a lot about them now, but the reality is, you know, we're not out of the woods this time yet, you know? So if you're not familiar, that's Dr. Anthony Fauci from the National Institute of Health here in the US, you know, and this past fall, he said that he expected it would be easily the end of 2021, maybe even into 2022, before we got back to some semblance of normality. In Canada, our chief medical officer, chief public medical health officer, Dr. Theresa Tam, I liked her phraseology with this, that Canadians should expect to live with the current inconveniences for the next 2 or 3 years. And that was a comment she made in late July, or I think it was the 27th or 28th of July of this year, right? So not just this school year, but next school year, maybe the school year after that, you know, and what are those inconveniences? You know, the potential for, you know, just the physical things that we've got, you know, masking, social distancing, barriers, that kind of thing, but also the potential for us to, you know, have to flip back because, you know, there's a lot we don't know about this. And, you know, when it comes to herd immunity, I mean, the numbers that have been put out there anywhere, you can see the WHO here have basically said that, you know, it's between 60 and 70% vaccinated plus the folks that have already gotten it. Well, one of the things we've already discovered now is many of these variants that are coming out are impacting people that have already gotten it. So they really can't be counted on for herd immunity. You know, Dr. Fauci here in the US has said 80 to 90%, maybe as low as 70. Theresa Tam has said 80% on a regular basis, you know, but there's still a lot that's happening. And, you know, while most of us, when you look at these variants of concern, as an example, know about B117 and B1351 and P1, you know, the UK, South African and Brazilian variants, to be exact, most people wouldn't be able to tell you what the B4, the B1427 or B1429 are. there are two California variants, one in San Francisco and one in the LA area, that have been, found to be circulating here and have been found to be almost as contagious as what the UK variant is. And so there's a lot that we don't know other than the fact that there are waves. And while many places are in their third wave right now, we don't know if there's going to be a fourth or fifth wave. In fact, if you go back to the Spanish flu, these are the three waves that hit with the Spanish flu. Does anyone know what happens to the Spanish flu come May of 1919? You can drop it in the chat if you do. I'll wait 10, 15 seconds to see. So the Spanish flu doesn't disappear in May of 1919. In fact, I'm willing to bet that every single person in this room has had the Spanish flu at some point. After the third wave, the variant or the mutation that happened with the Spanish flu essentially became the common flu, the flu that we all get a vaccine for every single year. And usually there's three or four or five different variants in that cocktail of that vaccine. So from May of 1919 to today, the Spanish flu has continued to exist. We just got lucky in the fact that it mutated to something that was no longer deadly as it had been in previous mutations, right? Is that what's going to happen with the COVID virus? We don't know. One of the things that, again, the only thing that we do know is that, it's going to be around with us for a while. And even if it's not, there's another one that's going to come. We interact with animals far more now than we ever did. So that, human to animal, back to human jump is going to happen more and more. And while we might be able to get 70 or 80% vaccine rates this time around, what happens if the variant that, they discovered in New York, as an example from last May, is something that's vaccine resistant, or the Brazilian variant that, or the one that's just been discovered in India is vaccine resistant? What happens if we need a booster 5 years from now, 3 years from now, 2 years from now? What percentage uptake do you think you're going to get with that? I looked at the European Union numbers earlier, and on average, you get about 30% at best of people that actually get the flu vaccine every year. What if COVID is something that we need to be vaccinated for every other year, every 5 years, every 3 years? What's the uptake going to be then, and how does that impact things with herd immunity? So this idea that, we need to be able to understand what we do in each of these three phases and be ready for it is something that needs to be not just considered, but planned for. And when you look at jurisdictions that did well this time around, they didn't do well because, they were somehow smarter than us. They did well because something happened to them once upon a time, and in most cases in recent history, that forced them to get ready for that. If you look at several countries in Asia, Hong Kong and Singapore being two among them, Bolivia was another one, that were hit with the H1N1 outbreaks that we had about a decade ago. And because of what happened during those things, they got ready for it this time. The earthquakes that happened in New Zealand and Christchurch in particular back in 2011, allowed them to really think about what do we do when we've got to close the entire school system for extended periods of time, and so there are a lot of things that, we need to be ready for and we need to continue to think about as we're looking forward. So I know we got started a couple of minutes late, and I think I finished right on time. And I don't know how much time you had set aside for questions or not, but I'm ready for them there. And I'll just put that up since that's got my email. So in case you don't get a chance to ask a question or something comes to you later in the day, by all means, reach out to me. And I'll let you all take the moderate the Q&A here, although I've been watching the chat and I haven't seen anything come through.
Well, thank you very much.